tell everybody. Oops. I server muted him.
I was like, guys,
how do I mute him? Oh, I got it. Cold hard cash. Wait, Velvet, speak.
No.
Okay.
Now you still gotta mute him.
Like, I did.
Okay. Are you ready, guys?
Yeah.
Still sounds loud. Hold on. Super loud.
No, you can hear him in the background. Hold on. I'll be right back.
What is this?
This is a story called Barry. And so far in the story, what has happened is they have actually came and the protagonist is a owner of a lumber company, huge chop wood. And what has happened is he's gotten to an accident, and it was four of them in the crew. One is already confirmed dead, one is missing, and it's him and his very extremely injured friend. And his friend, they've gone into, fallen into the ground, where as they walk down the tunnel, they realize they're in this government facility.
Okay, there we go.
And as the government facility, they met one guy who they thought was pretty, you know, kind of weird, but he knew about the place. So as they got deeper into the story, come to find out there was an experiment, the lights went out, and these creatures from other dimensions have come, and they seem right now aggressive because they turn everybody inside out. And at this moment, the guy that you help has also met another woman who was the researcher, and she finally reveals more of the story, and he's like, you're the reason why you have hurt me, da 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 da, you know, you're the reason why we're going through this, so we should kill you. So the protagonist has already been in the fight with this guy, and we chosen to have him shoot the tank. So there's gross stuff leaking out of the tank, and we let the guy live. And the girl is shaking, and we're trying to figure out what to do now.
Okay, so
we totally this is should a story that we
choose to what happens.
What?
Yep, it's an we interactive what story.
In the story.
Yep.
Okay.
All right. Beginning chapter 4.
Do I start or do you start?
I'm starting. Damn it. The ride up the elevator is tense. I take a series of deep breaths, doing everything I can to stay in control. Amy has gotten back to her feet, but her head is pressed against the elevator wall as she suppresses a series of sobs. I find myself trying to remember the way those creatures looked, but my head seems shudder at the effort. I've seen something that is an impossibility. A mockery of what I know is real. This fills me with terror that dwarfs anything else I have felt since discovering this facility. I try to focus my mind on something else and remember Marcus' threats. I wonder if we'll see Marcus again, I say, mostly to myself. Do you think Marcus got away from these things? Amy asks. So do we answer probably or sort of hope not. What do you think?
Ooh.
I would try to reassure her and say I sort of hope not, Because, I mean, he tried to choke her out using a rifle.
Yeah.
He was gagging her with it, like her face was blue.
Okay, then I would go to it. I sort of hope not.
All right, Velvet, you're next.
All right. Me too, she says, looking at the ground, her arms folded. So, I say, how did you end up here? She gives a nervous chuckle and shrugs.
Who's making all the loud noise?
Used to work with the Pentagon. Some pretty upper echelon. Or echelon shit.
Spartan, can you, hey.
Here you go.
We're recording. Can you, like, mute yourself or push to talk, please? Spartan. Thank you.
Okay. I assume this place is even more upper echelon, I said. Echelon, how do you say that?
Just keep going.
Oh, okay. Echelon. This place isn't even on the scale, she answers. My other job was a cakewalk compared to this. Then why stay, I ask. Because the money is ridiculous. I have a 13-year-old daughter already talking about Harvard. You do the math. So, do we say, have any other kids? Or Harvard, huh? That's pretty ambitious. I'd go with, like, any other kids, because that's ambitious. Sounds kind of pretentious.
Yeah, I feel you.
All right.
And I mean, she's smart. Her kid's probably really smart, too.
All right, you ready, Fawn?
Yes.
This is your go.
No, just the one. Her dad split on us when she was 3. I never remarried, so no siblings for her. I may have only gotten one, but the one I got is amazing. Amy pauses before continuing softly. What if I never see? Her voice breaks off, the words too terrible to say. Her eyes fill with tears. The elevator comes to a stop, the slight ding of it interrupting the moment. Amy hastily wipes her eyes, and we waste no time in getting back inside the command center.
Where we saw the bloodshed. I ready the rifle, suddenly certain that there are more of those creatures waiting for us in the hallway of the second level. But the way is clear, allowing us to haul ass to the command center. Once again, I find myself staring at the screen that shows my ruined work site. Okay, okay, Amy says, typing commands rapidly. It can't be that hard. I keep peeking over my shoulder, my senses feeling as if the monsters are sneaking up on us, mere inches away. I then think of Dennis and wonder how he's firing back on level 3. Is he safe? I look back to the screens and see that Amy has finally found what she is looking for. A prompt on the screen says, override of hangar doors and all level 3 locks require clearance code. Amy types in a number with shaking fingers and the screen goes black for a moment. The moment the words override confirmed come up on the screen, Amy jumps from the chair and heads out of the room. We have to be quick, she says. We have exactly 20 minutes to open those hangar doors. Do we ask what happens in 20 minutes? Or then yes. Let's get moving.
Let's ask.
Ask the question.
Ask it.
I'm more of a do now, ask later, but okay.
The locks will kick in again, she says. Security measure. I couldn't do anything about it. I follow her out of the command center and bounce back down the hallway towards the same elevator that brought us here. Amy punches the elevator button, and the doors slide open. We're taking the same elevator back down to the biochem room? I ask. Those creatures are still down there. It's the only way back down, she says. The other way is blocked by those hydraulic doors we pulled. Hopefully the creatures left. Hopefully. Neither of us say anything else as we share a look of immense dread. We step back into the elevator and head back down into the biochem room on level 3.
Dun dun dun. Get ready, Fawn.
Sorry.
I got ask it.
As the elevator doors open, we peer out, looking to see if the creatures are still in the area. But it's all clear, save that strange green chemical leaking out of the tank I accidentally shot. The moss has started to expand and climb up the sides of some of the tanks. I'm distracted for a moment before realizing we need to move. When Amy looks to me, her eyes are clear and strong. Marcus wasn't entirely wrong, Amy says as we start walking back towards the hangar doors. About what? I ask. About how I am partially to blame for this. By the way, I can hear myself echoing, so it's going to be hard for me to read.
I know. Sorry. You're right, you are. Why would you blame? I mean, I could take the sound off and you don't have to hear the eerie sound.
Okay.
No.
Okay.
Okay.
So, do we say you're right, you are?
Let's not be a dick. Like, let's ask her why she would be the blame.
I would want to ask. Wait a minute, that was Fawn, so it's me, right?
Yeah.
Some of the things we do here, it's scary. I don't know why I said it like that. We should have known that one day something like this would happen. Everyone here, with knowledge of what goes on in Level 3, is to blame, she says. It's a highly advanced research facility, I say. Doing amazing but risky stuff. So yeah, you're partially to blame by just working here, but I can understand the dedication. So why don't you tell me a bit more about what does go on in Level 3, I ask. Are you familiar with the Large Hadron Collider over the Switzerland? I've heard the phrase, but that's about it, I said. It's a powerful particle accelerator, she explains. Right now, they're using it to try and create what is called dark matter. It's theorized that this dark matter actually makes up the majority of the universe, but parts of the universe very different from ours. My guess is the people that at the LHC will probably create their first dark matter particle in about 2018 or 2019. That's really soon. Here in this facility, we were able to create one almost 10 years ago. It was the key to our research. Now, do we ask, does this have something to do with these things? Or what does this matter do?
Well, I mean, it has to have something to do with these things. Like, there's no other way, so I'd ask, what's it do? We use dark matter to assist an instantaneous transfer of a subject. We have yet to perfect it or understand why it works. So, you're saying it lets you gain access to different dimensions? I ask. That's a theory, she says. During the point-to-point transfer, the subjects are gone for about 3 to 6 seconds. There's no way to see or measure their presence, but they exist somewhere. From what we can tell, they exist in a kind of void. So, what is that place like, or have you done this with people? They have to have done it with people. There was that one file in the control room, right?
Mm-hmm.
The guy that was all explodey and stuff.
I would say, what is that place like?
Yeah. We don't know. There may be an infinite number of voids or spaces. Some of them appear to just be nothingness, a vacuum or exotic matter. We're talking about places that we can only measure with instruments. What does that mean? I ask. Do you know what these places look like? No. It means in order to describe it to you, you'd have to be a mathematician, and I'd have to walk you through reams of data and equations. So even though we can describe them, we're still a long way from figuring out what these places look like. Sorry, I asked, I say, feeling my mind start to bend inward again. As we continue to walk between the silos, we walk past the area where we left Marcus behind. but he's long gone. Maybe he found a way out. I realized that we were walking very close together between the silos, perhaps trying to create the illusion of safety. We reached the exit connecting to the hangar doors, where Dennis hopefully still is. My guts clench, and my heart hammers in my chest as we open the door and walk through. I lift the rifle, but at first it seems that there is nothing waiting for us. And that's when I see the glowing, hulking shape to my left, closing in fast.
Oh god.
The creature is about 10 feet away and coming in quickly. So, I do the first thing that comes to mind. I drop to the ground, making myself a smaller target, and raise the rifle. I'm not sure if I should just unload on the bastard or try to be choosy with my shots and weaken it, or at least slow it down. So, should we shoot to weaken it or shoot to kill it?
God damn it. Well, I don't want to die, but we need ammo.
I shoot to kill, man.
Alright.
Because, I mean, they obviously killed my homies.
Yeah. But is that the smartest decision?
maybe not. The beast is less than a foot away from me when I start firing rapidly. I'm not sure which is louder, the gunshot or the high-pitched screeching as the creature staggers. With that, it seems to turn and jerk away, parts of it appearing and disappearing every few feet. It moves down the hall and out of sight. Apparently, even several rounds of bullets are only enough to slow these things down. I look around quickly for others, but there's only Amy. She looks at where the monster went with wide eyes, her face pale, and I wonder if, like me, she's able to feel her mind trying to retreat. So, do we ask her nicely, "You okay?" or do we just get moving?
Get the hell out of there!
Yeah, we're already shooting to kill. We might as well get moving.
Come on, I say. Let's find Dennis and get through these hangar doors. Amy glances at her watch and nods. We're already down to 6 minutes. We turn toward the hangar doors, and I'm a little disgusted with myself because the bloody scene that's so shocked me before now seems mild. Amy goes to work on the computer console on the side of the doors. She starts punching in keys before saying, "This is going to take some time." "I thought you already unlocked it," I ask. "I did," she says, "but for this door, there's still security permissions I need to hack. Marcus would have known how to do this." She trails off and I decide to let her work. Suddenly something slams into me. I feel my feet leave the floor and I'm literally thrown across the concrete. I look up in time to see one of the creatures. It's apparently in no hurry to attack me again, focusing on Amy instead. She's not armed. I need to come up with a plan to get this thing away from her so she can focus on getting the door open. It raises one of its flickering appendages, making me certain that part of its makeup is pure light and energy. I could easily take a shot with my rifle. But my mind again goes to how much remaining ammo I have. The only other thing I could think of is to get it to chase me and lead it away from this room somewhere.
I would distract this time, because obviously he's not gonna die. Distract the monster and run. "Hey," I yell, "right here, come get me. I'm the one that shot your buddy." It turns to me and I am again faced with staring at something that has no business in this world, in this reality. Its body gives off a sort of glow around the central part, a bulbous core that is branched off with two humps, very much like a spider. Again, I sense that this visual information is not accurate, but it's the best my simple mind can do to make sense of this impossible creature. It starts lurching towards me and lets out a shriek of agony that makes my ears feel like they'll explode. Now that I'm sure it's something after me, I take off running and head into another hallway we haven't been down. I find myself in an industrial looking area, and I am pleased to find that the monster has followed me through.
Dun dun dun!
Oh, schnapps.
Oh, that looks creepy as hell.
It's dirt.
The room seems to be an assortment of old plate pipes and tanks. I assume some of them run further down into other areas of the facility. With the creature on my tail, I dash into the maze of metal, hoping to lose it. It's definitely having a harder time squeezing through than I am. That slows it down. Of course, the room's not a cage of any kind. The thing is still headed towards me, shredding through the pipes as it rages. I notice that sometimes it is breaking the steel girders, but other times, it seems like it's somehow merging or changing them. Pipes that were separate are now connected together in a way that makes my mind hurt. I finally get a good amount of distance between myself and the creature. I think it's lost my trail. I need to get back to those hangar doors. There's not much time before they close shut. If I make a sound, that creature could be on my heels again. So, do I hide and escape quietly or run as fast as I can?
I think you should hide and escape quietly.
I think so too. At least we got him away from our friend. What do you think? Yeah.
I would hide.
Gotta take the stealthy way out.
It's like, ha! The hangar doors are shut. Amy went with you.
I take care to stay silent, twisting myself through some more pipes and making my way back towards the door I entered through. The creature doesn't seem to pick up on this. I see its glowing back as I come around. It lets out a static scream that makes my insides feel like jelly. But I don't even look back. I slide quietly through the rusted obstacle course and tiptoe back to the hangar doors.
Dun, dun, dun.
Look up behind you, all I can.
And geez again with the blood.
I burst back into the large room and see Amy still working on the computer terminal by the hangar doors. You okay? I ask Amy. I can clearly see her battling for control of her faculties. Steel determination wins out and she gives out a grim nod. Any sign of where Dennis went? I ask, hoping she hasn't noticed his body somewhere. No, she replies. It's then that I realize that I have no idea how many rounds I have remaining in the rifle. This isn't a model I'm familiar with. Outside of some deer hunting, I'm not much of an expert on firearms. Still, I am able to locate the chamber easily and see that there are 4 rounds left. Not great, but it could be worse. How are we on time? I asked her. 2 minutes. I'm going as fast as I can, she says. Amy does her best to focus on the keyboard, but there is still no sign of Dennis. Before I have time to look around, a screeching sound erupts from the other end of the room. I bring the rifle up into a shooter stance and turn around. With the hangar doors right behind me, no signs of Dennis, and a closing window of time, I have to be confident. Yet, when 2 monsters come around the corner, my body wants to shut down. The appendages seem to jump in time and space, reaching out for a split second, independent of the body, and then disappearing back to where they came from. It turns and screeches at me, its glowing tentacles snaking out of its body. My knees tremble uncontrollably. Behind me, Amy shrieks. I feel myself losing control, my mind sliding into the abyss of insanity. I pull myself back from the brink. I've got to stay in control.
Oh no.
Should we turn away or shoot?
Well, we have like 4 bullets. Oh god.
Guys, we gotta run.
But she's still there and we can't.
Oh shit.
We gotta shoot this time.
Good thing.
For those 2 minutes, we need those 2 minutes.
Fine. I guess we shoot. God dang it.
Shoot them.
I step away from Amy and the hangar doors towards the monster, ready to defend her. I ready my rifle, but the creature wastes no time. It makes that jerky motion towards me, and there's a sharp pain in my chest as it collides with me. Or through me. It's hard to tell. My instinct is to try to grapple or hold this thing down, but then I realize I don't even know if that will work. So, do we grab it or try to get away?
I would grab it.
Why would you touch it? Like,
you gotta
like...
do what you gotta do. I don't know, you guys.
What if it... See, but the thing is, it bends. It bends anything it touches. So if it bends anything it touches, if it touches you, you're gonna bend.
Well, okay, I mean, it's try to get away. Touching your chest, isn't it?
He says, but then I realize I don't even know if that will work.
Should he grab the entity that burns anything it moves through?
I don't know, dude. I trust you guys.
Oh, man.
We don't know what's going on. Hold on. I'm trying to get a coin.
What do you think? What do you think, Spartan?
I would suggest you grab it.
Everyone wants to touch it. I think it's gonna hurt.
You know what? Screw it. Let's grab it.
Oh god.
Grab him by the foot, please.
We're gonna lose our arms, guys.
Let's do this thing.
Oh god. I try to grapple with the creature, but it feels very different from my struggle with Marcus earlier. It's not easily grabbed. My fingers slide through the parts of it. Some parts like a ghost, others like a jellyfish. Touching it burns my hands, but only slightly. When I realize I can't grip it, I quickly spring away and turn to face it. With a scream of defiance, I raise the rifle and put a round in its core. The shot lands dead center and the light inside of it flickers almost violently. It falls back against the wall, issuing a hiss of its telltale static noise, and it jerks away and retreats, at least for now. Another terror appears, as if out of nowhere, screaming at me with its high-pitched whine. It bounds forward, charging in a strange, spastic way. I am the rifle. Oh no, I aim the rifle. I am Groot.
Be the bullet.
I have the book. I aim the rifle, intending to take this one in the core too. I take several shots, but it's still coming at me as it slams into me. I realize that I only have one bullet left. On contact, the wind is knocked out of my lungs and the back of my head strikes the floor. But neither of these things is as alarming as the fact that the beast is still on top of me. Its exterior is like a seashell that has been pounded by the surf for so long that it's lost all its edges and ridges, but the grip, it tries to capture me with its pure violence. I feel those light-soaked appendages start to wrap around me. I raise the rifle knowing I still have one shot left. The weight of the monster is erratic. One movement, I felt weightless. Another, I feel like I'm going to be crushed. I push upwards with the rifle to aim, but it was overpowering me. I'm not sure I'll be able to get an effective shot off. I see the core of its body, a spider-like shape, connected to the rest of it by thin, white strings of tissue. I know I'll be dead within seconds unless I can manage a shot, but I don't know where to aim. This thing's already survived for so long.
Dude, I don't know.
Shoot at the center or shoot at the tentacles?
Center. Cool. I go at the center.
I agree.
I mean, like, maybe it'll just kill the beast. Like, we saw that white appendage thingamabobber, like, flesh thingamabobber.
Why not shoot him in the head?
Because that's not one of the options.
Maybe it doesn't have a head.
Yeah, it's like this blobbly blob blob.
Right, in that case, the chest might be the best option.
Alright, let's do it in the center then.
Sounds hot. Sorry.
Question.
The creature is seconds away from tearing into my shoulder. I have to stop it now. I grunt as I try to angle the rifle in the direction of the beast's formless core. The appendages begin tugging down on the barrel, and it's that moment that I pull the trigger, unleashing my final shot. Thank God I saved this bullet earlier. The shot aggravates it enough to win some breathing room. I've saved my shoulder, but things still alive and kicking. But then I see the creature extend its tentacles into a violent whip-like motion away from me while it makes that static screeching sound. The creature disappears into thin air and reappears a few feet in front of me, retreating. With a shudder and a cry of desperation, I try to get to my feet, just in time to see the monster head into the direction of the biochem room. Amy looks over at me from her terminal at the hangar doors, looking petrified. I manage to help myself up when I see another figure nearing us. But to my relief, I realize it's a human figure, Dennis, with a gun. You okay, boss? He asks. His eyes aren't on me. They're looking at the creature, trying to understand exactly what he has just seen. About 15 minutes ago, I heard the door to that maintenance room unlock, Dennis says, pointing to the room I tried to bust my way into earlier. Ah, Amy says. When I did the override up in the command center, it unlocks all the small doors down here, including the maintenance room. I went inside and hid, Dennis continues. And while I was waiting for you, I came back. I found a massive trunk. There were a few guns in it, so I grabbed this one, he says, patting his shotgun. So, do we talk? I'm glad you're safe, Dennis. Give him a kiss.
Yeah, that one.
Or, glad you found some weapons.
Yeah. I think we should be glad he found weapons.
I picked the kiss.
Okay. No, so no kiss.
No kissing.
Kiss. Yeah, no problem, he says. She doesn't break eye contact with the panel. Almost done, she replies. Suddenly, without warning, a shot ricochets off the wall behind Amy's head. Startled, we look around, confused. Did Dennis's gun go off? When another shot blasts near us again, we all drop to the floor. I look around, wondering who or what could possibly be shooting at us. Those creatures don't do anything that sounds remotely like gunfire. And then I see him. Marcus. I should have killed him when I had the chance. He has a rifle and is walking toward us, an insane look in his eyes. You all deserve to die, he screams, unleashing another round that I hear whiz by my head. Dennis doesn't hesitate. He stands up and shoots at Marcus, causing him to retreat. I don't know, you guys.
Should we ask how much longer? Or open that damn door?
We should ask her how much longer.
Because I don't want to be a dick to him.
Yeah, she freaks out and she takes forever to do shit when she freaks out.
Okay. Yep.
Alright, we gotta kiss her ass. Almost there, she says quietly. She makes a few final key presses and says, done! The doors open with the noise of hydraulics and a whoosh of air. With Marcus pinned down by Dennis' gunfire, we start moving towards the doors. At that moment, another creature jerks into existence around the corner between us and Marcus. Shit! Marcus says, and starts unloading into it. But then he learns the same lesson we did. This only slows the creature down. Marcus gives us one last look and then turns and runs off into another direction. Dennis, Amy, and I climb up and head through the doors, moving on nothing more than adrenaline. I see her look longingly at the maintenance room Dennis took the shotgun from. You get into that hangar, Dennis says. I'll get some more firepower. Satisfied with the plan, Amy heads through the door. We scramble inside, finally inside the hangar. Dennis approaches from behind, holding several guns and looking like a kid who grabbed an armful of Halloween candy. Amy reaches out for a 9mm with one hand. Dennis turns to me and holds out a shotgun and a handheld gun for me to choose. Both look deadly. The shotgun looks more powerful, but the handgun will probably be more precise. Do we take the shotgun or the handgun?
You already have one shotgun.
Take the handgun.
We do already have one shotgun.
Go with the handgun.
Go with the sawed-off. Yeah.
Sawed-off is a shotgun, is it?
Yeah.
But, okay, so we're not really
at... Get a mag 7.
I mean, the sawed-off.
Swing 7.
Okay, we do have a shotgun already.
Get a motherfucking RPG.
We're gonna take the handgun.
You took the handgun. Oh, God, that was a big decision type deal.
Wait,
I suck the handgun and am comforted by the way it seems to fit perfectly in my shaky grip. There are more creatures coming, as many as a dozen. They're floating down the hall quickly, their tentacles slithering. The way their light seems to mingle together is almost beautiful. Close the door, I yell at her. She dashes to another terminal mounted on the inside of the hangar doors and tries to desperately close them. It's not working, she says with tears in her eyes. This terminal is disabled. Dennis looks through the open doors, readying himself to shoot the first monster that nears us back. Should we try to slow a few of them down or just run for it? He asks, his gun at the ready. So.
Run for it.
Slow a few of them down, one of them's gonna die.
Punch him in the head.
You got that adrenaline, you gotta keep it going.
We've been over this. You wouldn't be able to tell their butt from their head.
Run.
Be smart.
Hmm.
Cash them offside.
Run. We're gonna run for it, guys.
Run.
Ready?
Yes. Run. Good idea, says Amy. With that, we turn around and sprint out onto the hangar floor.
No. Oh.
Run.
Oh my gosh.
Here we go, guys.
Topside said, why don't we both run and shoot?
Because it's not accurate.
Go ahead, Vaughn, do this one since yours was like 2 lines long.
Okay. The room is enormous, so large that to call it a room seems silly. A large concrete floor stretches out below an expansive lofted ceiling. The area is mostly empty, except for one side, which has rows and rows of metal barrels. Back on the far wall is a lit area that seems to expose more rooms, labs, and machinery. Also in the rear of the hangar, I can see some kind of chamber or control center. Dennis and I follow Amy across the hangar floor. Behind us, a series of rough, slithering sounds tell us that the creatures have made their way into the hangar. From somewhere up ahead, a loud buzzing noise sounds out. Of the slight buzzing noise I'd heard in the forest. The noise that I've tried to avoid. I look ahead and see that in the far back of the hangar, a bright red light is flashing. There is a small hatch or door below the light. That hatch is open and I can see a shape inside it. I can barely make out the figure of a man standing there, holding an industrial microphone, and as soon as I see him, I hear his huge, amplified voice. It blares down over an intercom system and he sounds pissed. I don't know who the hell you are, he says, but this is a government facility on lockdown, and there are protocols to shit. I assume the curse coincides with the exact moment he sees the creature. Oh. They are making their way through the hangar doors. There are maybe 20 feet between us and the creatures. I act instinctively, firing twice at the come alive in my hands. One shot goes into the core of the monster, causing it to shoot backwards. Another shot slows down another. The accuracy I get with the 9mm is amazing. Amy and Janice take the cue and start firing as well. The floor becomes littered with the swirling white fluid from the wounded. What the fuck?
Slow it down for her.
I lost my place.
There you go.
Oh god. Go ahead. The floor becomes littered.
White fluid from the wounded creature's body, but they are not slowing down. The alarm keeps shrieking behind us, and when I turn to see if anything has changed back there, I trip over my feet. I hit the ground hard, and in an almost comic fashion, slide several feet across the floor. From the ground, I see that we have managed to turn back 4 of them, but I also see that my estimate of a dozen is off. There are at least 20 of them. They're sick, dim light, sinister, and gloomy. Their appendages seem to bind together as they come forward. My only hope of survival is that the man in the far doorway has somehow shut... What? Has somehow shut that hangar doors. His voice comes blaring over the intercom again, broken by the booming noise of the gunfire that we are laying down. Run here, towards the isolation chamber. I'm not sure how much time we have. I realize that I can sprint ahead of Amy and Dennis, or I can hang back and give them cover.
Ooh.
Keep shooting and cover the others. Don't be a fucking pussy.
Yeah, I would keep shooting. What about you? Are you gonna run? Like, man, fuck them fools.
I would keep shooting to cover them.
Me too. Go inside. Where that guy is, I say. I'll make sure we don't have any of those things right on our tails. I'll hold him back for a while. I know it sounds macho, but it also feels like the right thing to do. I have to at least try to give us some kind of chance for our escape. So, As Amy and Dennis run through the doors, I blast at the next thing that I can see moving. All I get from my troubles is that static-like hiss and high-pitched whistling noise. I'm able to beat them back a bit, forcing them to scatter. Each flicker of light is a small victory. If nothing else, I'm buying Amy and Dennis time. When I'm certain there is nothing more I can do, I turn and run. I hustle quickly, catching up to Amy and Dennis, who stop and turn to provide me with such cover fire. "There," Amy says, pointing to the small door where the man was standing earlier. The swarm is less than 15 feet away now, so furious that they are pushing through one another to get to us. I raise the handgun and fire, taking my time to aim. I hit one in the spider-like part of his body. I fire again, this time one in the core. I place two more rounds into this creature, eventually causing it to move backwards. We are in the middle of the hangar floor now, with the isolation chamber ahead and the monsters behind. Beside me, Dennis also fires. The kick of the gun jolts him, probably as a result of him being weakened from the blood loss. His shot lands through, though, causing a jerking stumble and a flickering of its light. "We're almost in," Amy yells. As we get close to the door, we hope will save us. Do you dash inside, or you tell Amy to go in first?
Tell Dennis and Amy to go in first, because this, yeah. I guarantee you, it's going to be like a cliche, and either the bitch or the guy that's weakened is going to trip and fall, and then they die.
Yeah, you go first.
Watch us trip and fall and die. "Get inside," I tell Amy and Dennis, motioning for them to move. Oh, to get moving with my gun. I open the door and give Dennis a push towards it. He resists, more eager to try taking down another of the beasts before he makes it to safety, but he eventually gives in. See, he would have held back and then got to hello. I wait a beat to make sure Amy is inside too. I fire off a few rounds on the creatures that are still headed for us, hoping to slow them down. When Amy and Dennis clear the door, I nearly dash inside. But then I feel something hot seep into my back. "Roger!" Dennis yells. The pain in my back is so immense that I barely notice the fact that I'm being lifted from the floor. I look down to see one of the creatures is using its flowing arms to grab me by my waist, its tentacles wrapping around me. I've seen enough hentai to know where this is going. It lifts me into the air, as if presenting me as a trophy to its friends. I try to focus, attempting to angle my arm in a way that'll allow me to aim the handgun and place a bullet in its body, but it's shaking me violently, and its body parts are appearing and disappearing in a way that makes no sense, another oddity of its structure. I can literally do nothing more than hang there like a rag doll, hoping to be saved. As it continues to hoist me up, screeching its approval, Dennis comes back out of the room and fires off a shot. The bullet catches the monster on the underside of its core, sending it backwards and causing it to freeze for a moment. It releases me and I hit the ground, dropping my gun and again finding myself unable to breathe. I feel slightly dizzy, but that fades when I see Dennis is still standing outside of the door. He's firing into the beasts like a madman, and doesn't see the one on his left coming in along the edge of the wall. So, we say, "Dennis, look out!" Or
push him into the, out of the way. Push that guy out of the way.
Well, if we push him out the way, we might get hit, and I already fell.
Oh, yeah.
Dennis,
look out.
God dang it.
I mean, he could either move out the way, or we could push him out the way and get hit.
Can we even move at this point? I mean, I'm assuming we can, but...
Because we can push him out the way.
I would just tell him to look out. If he dies, okay, whatever.
All right, then, I guess.
We'll just sit there and say, "Look out."
"Dennis, look out." Go.
Hearing my voice, he turns to look directly at me. But this is the opposite of what he needs to do. Behind him, the creature glides up, shaking back and forth in space as it moves. By the time Dennis turns and sees the creature coming, it has already drawn several of its appendages back to strike. Dennis tries to raise his gun, but it's knocked away by one of the tentacles. A second tentacle strikes, and Dennis is spun around and thrown off balance by the attack. Dennis catches himself before falling. A third tentacle wraps around Dennis's forearm, and I can see it squeeze, tightening it instantly. The tip of the appendage passes clean through his hand, its blood-soaked tip poking out through his palm. Dennis's face grimaces with pain as he tries to wrench his arm free. But the creature's tentacle has his hand speared like a nail through wood. In a moment of dark clarity, I realize that I can free him with a clean shot at the monster's tentacle. But it will likely mean blowing Dennis's hand off. Dennis, I yell over the creature's high-pitched static sound. Can you get free? I have a shot. Maybe. No, Dennis gasps as the creature tosses him around by his hand like a puppet. Don't shoot. I can get free. I can tell if he's right, but the other monsters are starting to encircle him. I need to act fast.
Oh.
Oh no.
You know what? Fuck it. I would just wait for him if he's.
Yeah, me too.
He says he can. Just screw it. Yeah.
He's probably going to die, but oh well.
Wow, yeah, we're just giving. We just gave up on him. First, we were about to, you know, risk our life.
Yeah, well, I mean.
Oh God.
Yeah.
So we're gonna wait for him to get away.
Sure, why not?
Yeah.
Oh, God. You mean free shotgun? Maybe.
He doesn't want to get shot at, so let's just let him do
yeah,
his thing.
True. Oh God, you waited to see if he could get. Dennis is fighting hard, doing everything he can to bring the gun around with his good hand. He's screaming as he tries to tear his hand away, screaming in both fury and desperation. This only seems to anger the creature, which then swats Dennis with another one of his tentacles, opening a deep gash across his cheek. His skin peels back and his eyes go wide with shock. The creature drops him to the ground as if playing with him. And then the floor and space around Dennis seems to warp. The bottom quarter of his body seems to disappear before I realize it's been merged with the floor, and at that moment I know it's over. Three others swarm him, surrounding the remains of his fallen body. I don't even hear Dennis scream. There's just a frenzy of the crackling, sickening wail sound. After that, there's nothing left. Fury, sorrow, and absolute rage surge through my heart. I grab my gun as the remaining beast comes toward me. They'll kill me, but I don't care. This is war, as far as I'm concerned. Amy grabs me from behind and pulls me hard inside. I try fighting her off, but she's persistent, and part of my mind knows she's right. Don't be an idiot, she yells to me. She practically throws me through the doorway. As I fall, I hear her fire off two shots before slamming the door closed behind her. I watch blearily as she punches a few buttons on a control pad on the wall. This is followed by a metallic click and the door locks. We are safe in the chamber, but Dennis is gone.
Oh, Dennis.
God dang it.
Oh, no.
Fuck, we were too bad. I mean,
oh well.
What could we have done if...
Honestly,
it's
less people to worry about.
But I'm saying, if we would have saved him, or if we would have pushed him out the way...
Yeah.
You think we would have got killed, too?
I don't know. We would have gotten injured, at least.
You ready, buddy?
I guess.
We just let our friend die, man.
Okay.
All right, Velvet, it's up to you now.
Please, no. We are now inside a large reinforced chamber of sorts, almost like the inside of a submarine. Near us is the door, shut tight. Far away from us, along the back wall, are all sorts of controls and monitors. It seems clear that this metal door is impenetrable, at least to them. I'm fairly sure that they aren't getting in. Dennis, I say. I'm sorry, Amy says, and I'm sorry for pulling you back. But you're walking to your death out there. I know, I say. That doesn't make it any easier. I couldn't quite see, but it looked like you may have been shot. You may have had a shot. Why didn't you take it?
Now the guilt trip comes.
Let's just see. He told me not to
shoot.
Fuck
to
it.
Shoot. I'm sorry, yeah. Amy, but that's what he said. Yeah. It was his choice to die.
Or should we say, I thought he would get away. So basically, this is do we blame ourselves or do we blame him is really the real question.
You're always supposed to scapegoat someone. He told me not to shoot. Yeah. It was his decision, you know.
Because I honestly didn't think he was going to get away. But I mean...
Man. I thought he would. Thought he would just still lose his hand.
So he should have shot his hand off. I mean, at least we would have the rest of his body. Or maybe that could have just made them more bloodthirsty and made it faster. Maybe I would have been like, infused.
Bleed out or some shit like that.
Or
Roger, Amy says. My God, I'm sorry. He's dead, I say, hoping that speaking the words will help me to understand what just happened. I came through all of this to try to save him, and he's dead. How did this happen? Why did I listen to him? Out of nowhere, an image of Dennis pumping his fist after winning a game of pool pops into my head. I can't reconcile that happy image with what I just saw. I feel myself zoning out, wanting to just give up, but I'm stubborn, and the fact that Dennis is dead is a cruel motivator. I have to get out of here, I say. What I don't say is that I have to get out of here so all of this trouble have been worth something. We are interrupted by a man's voice booming behind us. Just what in the hell do you think you're doing? The man roars. He's an older man who seems to exude power and authority, but he also looks tired and scared. I assume this is Barksdale. He walks over to us from the back recess of the chamber. We didn't have a choice, Amy responds. We had to. Did you override the locks on the hangar doors? Barksdale demands. Yes, I did, but we had to. Do you have any idea what you could have done? Amy doesn't answer right away. She is furious, but she is also scared and visibly exhausted.
Do we ask who is this or stay quiet?
I would ask. But that's me.
Yeah, I would ask just to make sure. I mean, chances are he is Barksdale, but staying quiet is kind of like throwing her under the bus.
So we gotta I guess we didn't defend Dennis. We might as well defend her, right?
Yeah.
Because we're terrible people.
Yeah, we are. Damn. Oh, I addressed my question to Amy, preferring to get my info from her rather than whoever this is. The man doesn't break eye contact with Amy. Colonel Barksdale, he runs the place, she says, annoyed. Look, Barksdale, she says. You can berate me and lecture me all you want when this mess is over, but right now, I have a wounded civilian here, and as you can see, several entities trying to get into this room. So if you can actually do something instead of sitting on your throne and yelling at me, that would be great. I am impressed by her guts and wonder if there's some sort of beef between the two of them. Surely working in a place like this could cause some stress and tension between the people. As we wait, I notice a small peephole in the door. I go to it and look to the things. They're still looking for a way in, but finding no success. I wonder if they can sense or somehow see me through the door.
Do you flip him the bird or do nothing? Oh my god. Jeez, I'll leave this one up to you guys. I'm over it.
I don't know.
Wait, is that actually the choice? Flip him the bird or do nothing?
Yeah.
Wait, yeah. We either flip off the creatures or do nothing.
I will flip him the bird.
There's gotta be a reason.
Let's put some humor in.
Then do it.
You guys ready to flip some birds?
Oh my god.
Yeah.
Fine.
Flipping him the bird.
I can't help myself. I hold up my middle finger to one and smile defiantly. I get a blast of high-pitched sound in response. You'll be reprimanded for speaking to me in such a way, Barksdale says to Amy. Reprimand me all you want. I'd like to survive this first.
Cover your ears, Barksdale shouts, walking away towards the far end of the room. Stay put until you hear back from me. Thank you, Amy says with fire in her voice. She then turns to me and says, better do what the man says. So.
I would cover my ears.
Same. Yeah. I would also cover my ears.
I clap my hands over my ears just in time to protect my hearing from a deafening blast. I can still feel my blood rushing out and wondering if this is what Dennis felt like at the beginning of his end. Before the sorrow of losing Dennis can consume me, something slaps against the wall of the room with a tremendous force. I assume this is just another of the monsters slithering along at the wall, but when I turn back towards the door, I hear something surprising. More bursts of a loud explosive noise start ringing out. Looking through the peephole again, I see the core of one of the beasts explode. It vanishes in a puff of smoke and clear liquid. Looking to my left, I see Barksdale in a shooting stance at the far side of the room. He's firing through a small slit in the wall. He's using some high-powered weapon, the likes of which I've never seen. I see a slight movement as the gun kicks, accompanied by a flicker of white light. Immediately, another monster is downed, its tentacles flailing around the room aimlessly as most of its core is torn through. I instantly feel gratitude and immense satisfaction in knowing that they are being picked off in such a way.
We
sit down and
fuck that. I'm gonna watch him.
Yeah, just sit down and rest. I mean, it's well needed. I'm pretty sure we're bleeding out, and I don't think we'll learn much from just watching him shoot a gun.
So you want us to... Super important. You guys seriously want to rest?
Yeah, we're bleeding out.
Oh my god.
Wait, but what if you need to use the gun in the future? You don't know how it works.
Exactly.
What if Barso ends up dying, so you need to know
But I mean, gun? That wouldn't really help if we bleed out.
But how is resting going to help?
God damn it.
They want to sit down and rest, so we're going to take the...
It's needed.
A slide... Wait, who's your turn?
Wait. It's my turn?
No, wait. Okay, I slide down against the door and simply wait. I'm listening to the occasional patter of what I assume is their blood on the wall. I don't know how much time passes. Maybe 5 seconds. Maybe 5 minutes. And I don't care. It feels nice to lay down. When the firing is over, I barely even notice it. Soon after... Barksdale walks back over to our side of the room. They're all gone, Barksdale says, and I have resealed the hangar doors. How'd you kill them like that, I ask. Classify weapon that, quite frankly, you have no business being near. Amy gets to her feet and returns to the panel on the wall. Thanks. How badly is the civilian hurt? Barksdale asks Amy, as if I'm not good enough for him to speak to. A nasty cut, Amy answers. If he gets some quick attention, he'll be okay. Okay, I'll have Strickland get a med kit. Strickland survived? Amy asks, sounding cheerful. Yes, and until you and your friend showed up, I thought we were the only ones. Hang tight, she's on her way. With that said, he retreats away to the back of the room, as if he can't stand to be around us. Amy approaches me and looks me over. You're in good hands. Strickland will be able to fix you up. Is she a doctor or something? Sort of. She's also a physicist? I think I said that right. But oddly enough, she spent time as a trauma nurse in the army. Is Strickland a friend of yours, I ask? She chuckles. Yeah, we've known each other for a while. The only women in a sea of overachieving men. Should we say... Barksdale sounds like a prick, or should we ask? You must be glad Strickland survived.
He's in a bad mood. His friend just died. I think it should be the negative one.
But we always have to talk nicely to her to win her over to open up more info.
True.
Yeah, why not?
Or what do you think, Velvet?
I'd go with the nicer option.
Are you sure? Or is that because I said
it? I don't know.
Alright, we gotta flip a coin.
I'm not sure which one's the better option here.
Because, I mean, we obviously know that she's okay, and she's obviously happy, so we kind of already know what the right side says. So, negative.
What benefit would have calling him a prick be?
Nothing really, especially if she likes him.
Yeah.
Okay, time to toss a coin.
Pretty sure. Okay.
Let's toss a coin. Head's a prick, tail's a survive.
Add some drama in this,
well,
mama.
I'll just tell you whichever one it's tails.
Head's a prick.
It was tails.
Yeah.
You must be glad.
I told you. Good.
I am. We usually have lunch together, she says. And she's helped me out of a few tight spots in my career. Within a few seconds, the door behind us opens, and a woman appears from back further in the chamber. She enters the room with what looks like a small suitcase. She's dressed in a very basic and drab military getup, complete with a holstered sidearm. My name is Connie Strickland, she says, getting straight to the point. I can patch you up pretty good, but it's going to hurt. I nod, honestly not caring how much it hurts. My God, I just want to get out of here, to get home. Sit down, and let's see if we can get your shirt off, Strickland says. I sit down slowly, start unbuttoning my shirt. She has to help me slip it off of my shoulders, but we manage. How bad is it? I ask. Bad, she said. It almost looks like a burn, but I've seen much worse. I might as well talk to Strickland, if only to distract from the pain. So,
I'll ask, what's yours? Nah. What's your story?
Yeah.
All right. I go with the story.
Strickland rolls her eyes as she gathers up a needle and some thread. I was always into fringe science. I started in labs where these eccentric Russian scientists were being funded by the U.S. to work on combining DNA types. I sort of became obsessed with perfecting human physiology while I was a trauma nurse in the army. You are a mad scientist, then, I say. I get that a lot, but no, not compared to the stuff we do here.
Do we say what kind of stuff? Or I don't even want to know.
Sure, why not? What kind of
stuff? He's like super fed up with everything right now.
Yeah, but he's us. We're still, this is a new chick, man. That's fresh meat.
Oh my God.
Is she single?
I know, right? What kind of stuff? It's complicated. Comar masses, quantum gravity, crunching things down to their Schwarzschild radiuses. Fun stuff.
Schwarzschild.
Yeah, whatever. Yeah, a mad scientist, I say, trying to keep myself calm with dry humor. There are a lot of small labs working on the same stuff, she argues. They just don't have over our funding. When you guys ran in here, she says, I was horrified. Those barrels outside, I'm not sure if you saw them. Well, if you shot them, it could have been bad. Why? I ask. The gray ones are filled with an experimental fuel that is highly flammable. The yellow ones contain liquid nitrogen. What? I just lying around? Well, this area is the safest in the building, the most secure. Well, it used to be anyways. And take this, she says, handing me four pills. Painkillers. They won't work immediately, but they'll dull the worst of what you're feeling. Are these the best idea, I ask? Won't they make me dizzy or out of sorts or something? All I get in response is an annoyed and determined look.
God dang it. Like, do we trust her or not? Because, I mean, we're in a top secret government facility. Maybe they're trying to drug us so then they can go and just do funky stuff with us. I don't even know.
But, I mean, it's drugs, man. So you take some pain pillars.
But you know what?
Fawn.
Well, what? I would do a drink.
Which one?
Are we taking pills or are we not going to take the pills?
Well, his senses will kind of become I say don't take them.
All right. We're not taking the pills.
Okay, then. You refuse the painkillers. Oh, God, that one was a major decision. Really, I say. I don't want to get lightheaded in case we have to move fast. I can handle it. Your call, Strickland says as she starts working on me. She slathers the wound with some sort of liquid that stings like crazy, and I gasp. So, do we say,
he's a strong guy.
You just grin and bear it. All right.
All right. Ready to stab me yet? Strickland asks. Oh. I'm fine, I hiss. I wince as she dabs at my eye, swollen from where Marcus kicked me. I grip my teeth in pain and try to catch my breath. The anticipation is the worst part. I'm relieved to find that it doesn't hurt as much as I feared. It's no picnic for sure, but compared to the fire, like pain in my wound, it's bearable. So you and Barksdale are the only survivors? Amy asks. It seems that way. Those that didn't disappear into thin air were killed by those things, Strickland says, nodding to the secure door.
I would ask how many were killed.
Yeah, same. Because, I mean, like, we kind of had that, like, no one else made it question answered, like, 4 or 5 times now.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm guessing 30 or so, Strickland says. I'm not sure how many were scheduled to come in today. I'm glad to see you. Where were you when it happened? Amy asks. I was in the micro lab on level 2, Strickland replies. Park and O'Brien were in there with me and they just disappeared, I guess. It looked like they were being stretched, distorted, and then there was a ball of white light and they were gone. The ball of light was annihilated everything it touched. Would it leave a perfectly round hole? I asked. A light bulb turning into my head. We saw some of those up at the logging site. That was probably the same phenomenon, Strickland replies. Amy looks like a child afraid to ask an adult for something. Finally, she asks, where did they go? We don't know, Strickland says. It could be an infinite number of different dimensions, or even some dimensions that merge and mix together. It could also be a place that exists between dimensions. Barksdale calls it the void.
So, do we try to sound like a badass? Kind of. Or do we ask, how is that possible? it's like, how is that possible? Or, I'd call it dead.
So this is more of a, do you want to continue opening the story? Or do you want to close the story? Because if you say, I'll call it dead, pretty much, it's like, okay, whatever you say.
That's like the beginning of a new thing.
I
want to continue with it.
I want to see you. How is it possible?
Yeah.
Oh. We don't know that just yet, Strickland says. Our understanding of space-time is evolving. Especially when you start warping it like we have been doing, Amy adds. That point seems to be the end of the conversations, as both women fall quiet. I wince through the rest of Strickland's stitching, feeling the tug of my skin, but thankfully no more flowing blood. Finally, Strickland says, you're good to go. I slide my shirt back on, aware of the thick pad of gauze that Strickland applied to my shoulder. So, have you and Barksdale been able to contain all of those creatures? Amy asks. Strickland appears shocked, clearly not the reaction Amy was expecting. Contain? Are you nuts? Do you not know what's happening? Amy's eyes widen in fearful confusion. What do you mean, what's happening? Other than the initial experiment failure? The anomalies are becoming more numerous and further from the source, Strickland says. The casual humor in her voice is gone now. So, do we ask what anomalies or further from the source?
Further from the source, because we know what the anomalies are. They're the creatures.
Okay.
From the location of the original experiment, she says. The experiment caused the first doorway to open. but it set off a chain reaction. They were gaining momentum along geodesics emanating from the facility. It's these pockets of exotic matter and negative energy that are letting those things in. What the hell does that mean, I ask? It means, Amy chimes in, that those doorways, the monsters, are starting to appear all over the facility. Maybe even the surface. Not yet, luckily, Strickland says. But the doorways will start appearing on the surface, and it won't stop there. The anomalies reach could extend infinitely as far as we know. Those entities will appear on the surface in other states, other countries. Holy shit, I say. You mean the world is going to be overrun? The horror of the past few hours has made me ready to believe anything, but this is almost too much. Unfortunately, yes, Strickland says. My God, Amy says, stepping away. Isn't there anything we can do? There's a last resort, Strickland says, her eyes darting over to Barksdale at the back of the room. There's an emergency fail-safe switch. What? Amy says. I never heard of that. Where? You weren't cleared for it, Strickland replies. And that switch, Amy says, is a way to stop this? Yes, Strickland says, seeming uneasy with the conversation.
I want to know what it does, because, I mean, it might nuke the whole place and we might be dead. The switch is our eraser, she says. It destroys the entire facility and terminates any systems or experiments that are being conducted. It's also an emergency shutdown for an interdimensional travel. It puts an event horizon around the facility.
So literally a black hole.
What the hell is it? I ask, incredulous. It's the perimeter of a black hole, she replies. The boundary inside which nothing can escape, not even light. But there's two problems with hitting the switch. So the first problem is we'll all be killed, sucked into a black hole before we have time to evacuate. The second reason, Strickland whispers, suddenly quiet, is that Perk stills won't allow it. What? She asks. Why not? He won't allow those things to flood the surface? Thousands, millions will die. Strickland puts her hands up, silencing Amy. They both peer over to the far side of the room where Barksdale has his back turned. I know. He says he doesn't care. He says he'll be happy to be rid of oversight so he can continue his work. The oversight? Amy almost screams, regaining control over her voice when Strickland gives her another look of warning. You mean our government? I ask. He's aware this could disrupt even topple our government, and he doesn't care? Strickland sighs. Barksdale is, well, he's off the range right now. He's gone rogue and he's armed. This comment makes me look towards the handgun I brought with me. I nearly forgotten it in the last few moments. While Barksdale has his back turned, I take it in my hands and slide it behind me. Just in time, too, as Barksdale's walk over the back of the room to our side of the chamber. He gives Strickland a suspicious look before speaking to her. Is the civilian going to survive? He asks. Yes. He's jumping good to go, Strickland replies. That's great news, Barksdale says. I'm sitting right here, I say sarcastically. You can actually speak to me, you know. Amy, it's quite nice to see that you have survived, he says. Were there any others? The aloof way this asshole is talking to us is getting under my skin. A guy named Marcus that works on the first level from IT, Amy says. That's all I know for sure. Marcus Papscott. Barksdale says. Where is he? We're not sure, I say. He was separated from us. Oh, Barksdale replies, clearly taken aback by my stern reply. That's unfortunate. Barksdale seems to think about something and then looks directly at me. You're with the logging crew, aren't you? Remind me, how did you get in here again? Do we say we were trying to get away from here? Or do we just tell him the truth? We fell through a hole.
We fell through a hole.
Ah, right. We lost our primary power source when the experiment failed, Barksdale says. The experimental failure created those exotic matter pockets, that hole you fell into. And if there were enough of them, it may have opened a way into our facility. Depending on the power sources that were damaged, Barksdale continued, it could have also shut down the locking systems before backups kicked in. Everything is starting to make sense now. From the very start, it had seemed peculiar that we'd been so easily able to walk into a place like this.
So, where's the rest of our crew? Or what caused the experiment to fail?
Oh, we pretty much know our homies are dead. Because, well, they already been constantly asking, is that all? Is that all? So obviously, the crew ain't there. So, I would say what caused the experiment to fail.
Yeah.
Okay. Your crew hit one of our main power lines. We aren't exactly sure how, but we know that's what it did. You're trying to blame all this on me, I roar. The timing was unfortunate, Barksdale says.
Well, shit.
So what now?
I guess we can ask where is our crew now. Or
sure. Yeah.
Because, I mean... Your crew? Barksdale asks. Frank and Joe, they're gone. Gone? Gone where, I ask. My voice trembling, hearing him speak the names of my crew enrages me. They were annihilated by the antimatter pockets created during the failure. A bright ball of light. In the aftermath, all you see would be a round hole in the ground. Barksdale says this like he's sharing yesterday's sports scores. I let my face crumble into my hand. I had suspected this. All this time, and they were already dead. So, Amy asks, what do we do now? Now, it's the time to continue our work, Barksdale says, calmly, turning away to the instruments on the near wall.
How does this guy know that they were, like, taken, like, you know, in the things, the antimatter pockets?
Remember, there are cameras everywhere.
Yeah, but, like, remember how Marcus was watching the cameras and, like, I thought, no, well, screw it. Also, I would say let's keep quiet instead of saying they're insane, because if we tell them they're insane, Barksdale will start to suspect us.
And then he'll also probably put that antimatter gun in our face. All right. You ready?
No. I mean, no. This guy sounds like a complete lunatic, but he's a lunatic that's accustomed to power and armed with some type of advanced weaponry. So, I keep my intentions unspoken, assuming Barksdale is used to going unchallenged by the people he considers beneath him.
Ah! Can't talk!
He certainly seems like that type. I want to continue my work, Barksdale muses. Other researchers will eventually discover what we have, for sure. But I want it to be me. This is my laboratory. These are my experiments. The work I've led here will earn me my place in history. Quite frankly, I don't need to explain it to you. Up on the surface, they'll struggle to defend themselves since they won't know what they're dealing with. I have the necessary weapons. After a few months, who knows? Maybe I'll decide the world is ready for me to help them. We'll go from there. He turns his back to on us as he says this, walking to the far side of the chamber like we're some kind of distraction. Amy takes this opportunity to whisper to us, "We need to hit that switch," she says. "It's the only option. What he's saying is murder, treason, genocide." She looks over to Strickland for support, trailing off. But Strickland looks at the ground, clearly torn. She won't look at anyone in the eye and makes an effort not to look at Barksdale. He seems distracted with whatever instruments he's studying on the far side of the room. At this moment, I realize my body feels like a bomb went off inside it. Maybe those painkillers wouldn't have been so bad.
God dang it!
Strickland finally whispers a response. Even if we decide that we want to hit that switch, Barksdale won't allow us. So, do we say, to hell with it? Or, like, we can figure something out, right?
Hmm.
I would say you can figure something out, right?
Yeah, because obviously going straight forward with this guy, he's already planning on blowing everybody up.
Or letting everyone die.
Yeah.
Maybe you guys could make a break for it. Strickland whispers. Where's the switch located? Amy asks. There's an elevator out in the hangar, Strickland says. Take it to the basement. The switch is at the end of a long tunnel. But Strickland never finishes. Two things happen at once as she speaks, her mouth stopping in mid-sentence. What? First, a loud booming noise rings out, and then the top of her head seems to explode. Amy screams out in surprise, and I jump back in shock as Strickland's body collapses beside me. Behind her fallen body, Barksdale is holding his experimental rifle, and now he's pointing it at us. What?
Wow. He just blasted Strickland's head in front of us. Fuck. Okay, guys.
That's fucked up.
What the fuck?
Oh, now there's blood on the wall.
Oh, no. I wonder if Barksdale is even crazier than Marcus. He just shot a woman that worked for him to keep her quiet. Surely he won't have an issue with killing me. Now! Barksdale, no more whispering, no secrets. You two will stay in here, and I will get away from that door. If anyone whispers one more thing, I'll blow your heads off. My mind is racing to figure out a way to get through the secure door and into the hangar. Beyond that, of course, there was the failsafe switch. Insult Barksdale or make a distraction?
He seems really like an egomaniac.
Wouldn't insulting him make a distraction, or should we just make a distraction?
I don't know. It sounds like both are the same thing, honestly.
Yeah. I wouldn't really want to make him more angry at this point in time.
Okay, then, yeah, make a distraction, I guess.
What is that? Go.
I'm sorry. I try my best to be a good actor as I wobble on my feet a bit. I stop, start forward again, and then wobble some more. Amy is apparently catching on because she's at my side in a second. She looks over at Barksdale and says, "He's lost a lot of blood. Let me check his wounds really quick." After he dared to talk to me like that, he's been through a lot, she argues. He's clearly delusional. You can check him out back there, Barksdale says. You have 30 seconds to get away from that door or I stretch out my acting skills and actually stumble on a knee. I make a show of trying to get to my feet and stand still for a moment. I'm okay, I say. I'm okay. As quickly as I can, I raise my gun and fire. I don't even take aim. I just fire at Barksdale's general direction. Barksdale takes off running as my shot misses wide. He runs for cover at the back of the room. That's all we need. Amy also fires a shot to keep him under cover as we head for the door. Amy pushes a button and the door swings open. Barksdale will be on us in a second, so we dash out to the hangar, ready to defend ourselves. Oh my god. Can't talk.
Amy and I run as fast as we can through the rows of barrels. Barksdale comes charging out of the chamber almost immediately. As he steps onto the hangar floor, he starts shooting. Each shot sends a jolt of fear through me as I wait for a bullet to end my life. We need to get to the elevator on the far side of the room, Amy tells me. It leads down below to the switch.
This is a run situation to me.
Yeah,
but then again, he could shoot us. So, should we fend off, or should we run?
I feel like he is a lot more trained at shooting guns.
Yeah, I feel like it would just slow them down.
So we need to fight him.
Yeah. What?
Let's fend off Barksdale, meaning we have to fight him, or do you want to run away from him?
Run away.
It's run. Like, he's way better trained than we are. It's like...
Okay, let's go. Okay, she says, go. I take a few shots in Barksdale's direction, succeeding in getting him to take over and pause his stream of fire. We both make a run for it, knowing we have only seconds. Somehow, I make it through the rows of barrels and get to the elevator's entrance. I turn back to allow Amy to enter first, but she isn't there. I look back at the barrels to see that she's fallen about halfway down the row. She doesn't appear to be hurt, but she's paralyzed with fear, sitting motionlessly as Barksdale peppers the area with gunfire. Do we shoot back or run back and give her cover? We gotta get her. We can't keep losing our homies.
Yeah, I agree.
Especially the chick. She might be the last one in the world.
Man, you thirsty. I start to step out into the open to head back for Amy, but Barksdale's gunfire pins me back into the elevator entrance with a loud bang. Apparently, he's reloaded that weapon of his. As the sparks fly inches from my face, I realize that I have to help her from here. Then I remember the contents of the barrels. One color is highly flammable fuel. The other contains liquid nitrogen. I'm no scientist, but I'm pretty sure liquid nitrogen is mostly harmless unless you have direct contact. If one of those barrels gets shot and the liquid nitrogen spills out, I'm fairly positive it will simply evaporate. That could create cover of sorts for Amy, like a smoke cloud. Ah, hell, but which of the barrels holds the liquid nitrogen? Strickland told us, but I can't remember. I have to remember quickly, or Barksdale is going to get careless with the shooting and we could all die.
It's the gray.
Do we shoot the gray barrels or the yellow barrels?
It's the gray barrels.
All right.
Do you guys remember?
I don't, but I'm pretty sure that the more glaring thing, like the more like glaring color, will be the explosive.
Yeah, I think so too.
Watch it. Oh my god.
Come on.
Please. You decided to shoot. Oh, I was really.
Gray. Yes. Pretty sure the gray barrels have liquid nitrogen in them.
Thank God. Regardless, for memory.
I don't have time to second guess myself.
We don't know yet.
I take aim and pull the trigger, hitting a gray barrel 20 feet or so away from Amy. There's nothing at first, and just as I wonder if I've hit an empty barrel, there's a deafening explosion of fire. It knocks me to my ass, and I can hear Amy screaming. As flame and debris rain over me, my heart sinks. It wasn't the gray barrels. I just shot a barrel full of fuel.
God!
I stand up, feeling that the hairs on my arms have been singed slightly from the fire. I can see Amy out there. Her leg is on fire, and she's doing everything she can to roll it out. Shit. But everything she rolls, there's a mark.
You have to be kidding.
Just as I'm about to run down, I hear a gunshot. I freeze for a moment, assuming the shot is meant for me. But as I watch, a large red hole blooms in Amy's back. As she topples over, I glance up to see Barksdale with his gun, proud of his kill. Sorrow and fury boil up within me, but I have to keep it under control. I have to get to that switch. With Amy gone, there's nothing else for me to do here. I turn away from the hangar and head to the elevator. My nerves are drenched in fear and adrenaline. And I reach to the press and press the call button on the elevator. It feels like I'm watching someone else do it. I step inside and the doors close. The motors on the elevator sound like dying dogs. As the elevator slides down, the light from the flames give way to complete blackness. And now, I'm on my own.
Son of a God fucking damn it. Bitch!
Oh,
I'm
man.
Over it. This God damn it.
My bad.
You have to be fucking kidding me. They don't label this shit.
I lose track of how long elevator just started to turn due to the lack of the lighting. But it must go another 500 underground. The elevator comes to a stop with a shuddering clang, and it wastes no time exciting. Exiting, a tunnel stretches out with sparse white bulbs lighting the way. Most of the wall is made of raw earth and rock, but there were boards and concrete slathered in areas used to reinforce the tunnel. I'm sorry, I lost.
Fuck you.
I'm so... Sorry, I'm posted on the wall. I want to read it, but there's not much time. Should we read the notice or head towards the tunnel?
Head towards the tunnel.
I want to read, because last time we didn't read.
No, it's not that.
I'm...
read or not read?
So, just read it.
Why are you so bad? Okay.
God fucking damn it.
He's not over the fact that Amy died.
Oh, sorry, man. I guess he's not even gonna read.
We like gave Marcus the rifle, then Marcus tried to fucking kill her with it, and then we tried to save Dennis. He said he had it, then he didn't, and then he got fused to the floor and died, and then here's Amy, and then it's like we can't even remember. We should have shot the yellow arrows or the gray arrows. Oh my god.
Oh my god. Warning, authorized personnel only beyond this plane. Trespassers will be prosecuted to the full extent of the law. Absolutely no exceptions. Well, glad we got that out of the way. Now that everyone is dead, after only a few steps, the pain in my body intensifies. How stupid was I to turn down those painkillers? I look up, and when I see the tunnel ceiling is less than 6 inches over my head, claustrophobia freezes me for a moment. Still, it's much better than facing monsters above me. I wonder then, walking through the darkness, where they come from. Is the portal still open? The bulbs do little to thwart the darkness. I hold the gun in one hand and reach out to touch the wall with the other. Feeling the wall under my palm anchors me to reality, to sanity. I'm not in some balanced abyss, but still in the real world. For a little while longer, at least. I recognize I'm marching through my end. As much as I wish I weren't, it's not surprising. For the moment, I saw that those creatures could do the same, could do the time and space. At least a part of me knew that death was inevitable. Before I have time to wonder where my family were really missing me, I see a light ahead. It's nothing more than a speck of blue light, but in the darkness of the tunnel, it's like a lighthouse on a stormy sea. I slog forward, my eyes strained to focus on that little light ahead. From somewhere ahead, I start to hear something that sounds like water. Is it trickling? Oh, it is trickling lightly, like a leaky faucet. And beyond that, there is something that sounds like a wind, a light breeze through an open field, and a voice. Anywhere else, the sound would have been pleasant. But here in the blackness of the tunnel, they're menacing. Do we say hello or do we stay quiet?
I don't know anymore.
Shh, you still gotta make decisions whether you like it or not.
Okay, fine. Stay quiet.
We're always creeping.
Jeez. I don't make a sound, instead trying to make sense of what's going on around me. I cock my head, trying to concentrate, and then realize that I can see the tunnel walls now. This is odd, as I wasn't able to see them a few seconds ago. This is different from the blue light at the end of the tunnel. It's then that I see the slight shimmering in the air. It looks like a fogging mirror steamed over after a shower, and it's moving, dancing in the air like some abstract firefly. It's not menacing like the creatures, so that threat is null. It's peaceful, serene. I watch as this shimmer branches out and becomes two, then three, then four. They snake out in different directions, tracing the tunnel walls. Are these shimmers the doors to another dimension that Strickland was talking about? Suddenly I'm surrounded by light above and below me and realize there's no avoiding it. The question is, how am I going through? Feet first or head first?
I always go with my feet. I'm gonna put my head in there.
Okay.
What do you want? You want your feet first or your head first?
Feet first, I guess.
Unable to resist, I step forward to where the tunnel wall should be. When I do, those shimmering lights branch out even more before connecting in one perfect circular form. They're hypnotizing so much so that I don't realize that the tunnel walls are vanishing. I feel something like wind and a brief electrical pulse pass through me as the lights take me. There is then a very gentle pushing sensation. I somehow know that I am being expelled. I have passed through something, maybe the lights, maybe the tunnel walls, I don't know. but the shimmering lights fade a bit, still dancing in the air, but no longer large and branching out. And as my eyes adjust, I see right away that I am no longer standing in that dark tunnel far beneath the hangar. I have no idea where I am. I'm just somewhere else, and I'm terrified.
Dun dun dun.
Naked and afraid.
Oh. Ouch.
Whoa. Ooh. Okay then.
The ground I land on looks like hot coals. There are dips and many cliffs breaking the landscape ahead of me. There's a wash of orange and blue overhead in the sky that makes no sense. It is both beautiful and terrifying at once. A scattering of stars overhead, and they all seem to be breathing, pulsing, with a gentle energy, as if alive. I can't tell if there are clouds in the sky, because everything about it, from the colors of the trembling horizon line, seems amorphous. Everything is knitted together, living. I stare a moment longer, and can swear I feel the sky breathing. Far off to my right, I see what looks like to be a plume of fire, small yet bright, but no source of fuel. It looks as if the ground itself is creating the flame. Several more of these flames dot the landscape further out. The air is thick and muggy. Then I realize something horrible. I don't know if I'm breathing here resembles air at all. In a place like this, one of impossible beauty, but also very stark horror, in my mind doesn't know what to do. A wave of nausea comes over and I think I might be sick. I'm not sure if it would be better to fight it or give in. The white light that brought me here is nowhere to be found. Is anyone else even here? Is there any way to escape? Should we yell out for help, or should we look around?
I mean, I don't think we saw anyone. But I guess yell out for help? I don't know.
Fawn? you sound so defeated.
Oh my god.
Yell out for help. Or look
I would
around.
Yell out for help.
I take a deep breath of whatever otherworldly gas is filling this place and belt out as loud as I can. Hello? Hello? Is anyone here? Anyone? I hear a voice in response. It's faint, distant. I turn and hear it coming out of one of the massive crevices along the ground. Inside of that crack, about 10 feet down, a very pale man lies on a ledge. He is human, but looks close to death. He's in the center of a large pool of blood, and his left leg has been twisted and torn in an unnatural way. As I walk to the ledge, he looks up and sees me.
Help me, please,
the man says. His eyes are wide, although everything about him speaks of weakness. He is close to death, or insanity, or both. So, do we ask him, who are you, or what is this place?
I want to know what this place is. I don't care who he is. He's obviously a man who's got jacked up.
Okay.
Fawn?
Fawn.
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 Wait, 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 what?
Fawn.
I don't know, but we are outside of our home galaxy, possibly even our home universe. Please, help! I want to know more, but it seems cruel to steal what looked like his last breaths just to answer my question. I'd love to, I respond, but I don't know where the hell I am or how to get back home. The light, he says, it's a doorway. It might take you back to the facility.
Is it a mite or where did it go?
I would say where did it go.
Okay.
They come and go. They'll be back. Now please help me. I desperately want to help, but there's no way I can reach him. His ledge is too far away from above the pools of fire. I don't think I can get to you, I say. No, that's not what I mean, he replies. His eyes are on the handgun that I almost forget I am still holding. I realize what he wants and I shake my head. I can't. I say, I can't do that. Please, he pleads. Those things, they have the others that came here with me. I got dropped along the way. They'll be back. They'll be back and they'll kill me. That, he says again, indicating the gun, will be quicker, less painful. I can't, I repeat. Please, look at my damn leg. I'm dead anyways. I am about to refuse him again, and I hear an all too familiar static sound from the other another crevice behind him. I hear another one of those shrill noises and then watch as one of those monsters materializes up out of the neighboring crevice. Two more come out after it, then a third, then five, then ten. Soon I lose count as what was just a few turns into a flood. And I suddenly understand the man's reasoning. A bullet would be mercy. I check the gun and see that I have only one round left. I could use it on this guy, but I may need it for myself later. From beside me, the man pleads again. My God, he says, a waver of lunacy in his voice. Please.
God dang it. I'm going to sound like a dick, but I wouldn't shoot him. We would need the bullet. God damn it.
Yeah, and I mean, we already saw our friends get fucked up, you know what I'm saying? Might as well watch him, right?
Jeez.
I don't know about watch, but I just wouldn't shoot him.
No, we're going to watch.
Oh my God.
Get ready, buddy.
You did not shoot the man. I'm so sorry, I say. I can't. What I don't tell him is that I'm in a situation where I have to keep this one bullet. I can't waste it on him. He whimpers a bit, and I look away, unable to see that misery on his face. Behind me, I hear him give a mix between a scream mixed with the high-pitched noises of the army of creatures. The volume rises as he lets out cry after cry. I clench my teeth as the torture continues. Then, suddenly, his voice is silenced. And only the sick, static sound remains. And that's when I see the shimmers wavering to my right, in the direction I originally came from. I look back to the monsters and see that they have now noticed me. Some of them begin floating up the walls of the crevice. These are less than 10 feet separating us. There, well, the shimmers of white light are within arm's reach. Its movements reminding me of a fish in an aquarium. I reach out and feel myself accepted by them again. I feel the sensation of wind and wait for the feeling of them being pushed out, back to the tunnel of the facility. But it doesn't come this time. This time, I feel something else. I feel a tugging sensation that seems to want me wants to drag me in all directions at once. As the world goes dark, I realize that I am somewhere else. And it is not the darkness of the tunnel. This is the darkness of a total void.
Ooh. Dun, dun,
well, dun. We're in between dimensions. Yay.
Uh-oh. Oh, gosh. Fawn, tell us what happens next.
Next time on... I'm just kidding.
Oh. Where is it? There is darkness around me everywhere. Nothingness. I feel nothing under my feet. Nothing to my sides. I can't touch or sense anything at all. I don't even know which way is up or down. It's as though I am all that exists. And as I remain there, I just hear silence. Not even the sound of my heartbeat. The blackness is so deep that I feel I can't distinguish between my thoughts and what is real. I hear screaming, but I can't tell if it's someone else or my mind screaming to fill this void. I would try to move.
Me too.
Yeah.
I try to kick and move my arms. It's not working. But it's not clear in what way why it's not working. Are my limbs not moving or have they gone numb? It's possible to tell. Impossible to tell. My body has just become absent of all sensation. I assume this is the place I strictly refer to, the place between dimensions. This darkness could consume me if I wanted it to. I tried to will myself out of it, to have those shimmering lights spit me out, but it isn't happening. At this point, my mind starts to hallucinate, or at least I think it does. Are they visions? My mind playing tricks on me? I can't tell. All I can do is watch. I see the logging site. There's an image of Tony's lifeless body after I pulled it from under the dozer. I see myself talking to Dennis, and he looks distraught as I tell him that Tony is gone. Then the scene rearranges itself, and I'm standing in between Dennis and Marcus's gun. It changes again, and the shape of Marcus lies on the ground, still hell-bent on revenge after I let him live. In my mind, I'm sobbing as I watch Dennis get torn apart by those monsters all over again, and I just stood by and watched, and I tried to let out a scream as I watched myself shoot the wrong barrel, blowing Amy to hell. But there's still no sound. And just when I feel like I can't take any more of this, I see the man in that strange world begging for death. I'll watch as he's distorted and torn by those beasts. All of these things are flooding in my mind, and it feels like my brain is vomiting. Yet in the midst of it all, I see what's really important, the switch. In my mind's eye, I see that glowing light in the tunnel, the one far ahead, small in distance. Should I try to relax or should we focus on it?
Focus on it.
I think so too.
Yeah.
Focus our will.
I focus my mind on the tunnel and the image of that flickering light. With a mental effort so strong that it is nearly a physical motion, I make myself envision that little light in the tunnel as if it were right there in front of me. With that, I feel the wind again, a light breeze that seems to come from everywhere. And then, a relief that I can only imagine feels like death. I move forward.
You're gonna read this next one.
Oh, okay.
Oh, I can't. Back in the tunnel.
Dun, dun, dun.
I'm ejected from the void and I'm suddenly standing in a tunnel again. The tunnel again. I let out a wail of triumph that turns into a bout of weeping. The weeping only intensifies when I see that the light up ahead, a flickering blue light somewhere behind me. I hear a crackling noise. The monsters from that other place, they have come through. But not at the same time. They've gone down the tunnel the other way in search of me. And now, because of my crying, they knew I was here. I feel like I can listen to get a better read on where they are, or I can just make a break for it. So, do we run to the blue light or listen to hear where they are?
Well, I'm apparently the one with bad decisions, so. I blew up everybody, let people die. Oh my god. You know? Give the gun to the wrong person.
God damn it. Okay, hold on. I'm gonna flip this coin for myself.
We try to listen to hear where they are.
Is that the answer?
That's my choice.
Fawn. I try my best to listen, attempting to figure out how far away they are, but the sound carries strangely down here right now. The static sound makes it seem like they're about 30 yards away. Knowing my time is running out, I run as fast as my aching and confused body will allow. Head straight for the blue light. As I run, I see a different light. A white one, flickering in my peripheral vision. It's another one of those shimmers that go to other worlds. It seems like they're appearing and disappearing with more frequency now. Strickland was right. These things could reach the surface soon, unleashing more monsters. This thought makes me refocus on the blue light, the man-made light, the switch. The blue light gets closer, and as it does, I can make out a square shape around it. This has to be it. The familiar static scream of the monsters is much closer now, and I have to be quick. I grip the gun tightly, knowing I only have one bullet remaining, the bullet that the man in the other world who wanted me to use to end his life. I run ahead into the darkness, my eyes locked on the switch that I assume is going to not only kill the creatures, but myself as well. As I approach, I see the lever. It's covered by a glass box that I would need to break. The blue light is directly beneath this, highlighting a series of tubes and wires that snake into the inner workings of the device. In the middle is the blackness. Not like a darkly colored part of the machine, but just a hole in reality. It looks like some sort of illusion. All the while, I can hear the static of the creatures coming dangerously close now. I have no idea how much time I have. Should we turn around or smash the glass?
Smash the glass. We've taken up way too much time.
Yeah.
We shouldn't have listened, god dang it.
I draw back the stock of the gun and smash through the glass box that houses the lever. The glass shattering is like music to my ears. I reach out for the lever, my hands grasping it. Without warning, I feel immense pain course through my body. It feels like fire racing down my back, causing me to fall to one knee in agony. There's only one of them. That I can see. It blasts horrible static noise at me as I ready my gun. One bullet left. I'm very glad I didn't put that poor man in that other place out of his misery. I take aim and fire. My accuracy rewarded with the spew of white gas from the creature's core. It backs away, in defense or annoyance, I'm not sure. I start to turn back to switch when I hear a second creature come gliding up behind me. Its tentacles melt into me and I scream. I can't help it. I sound like a wild animal. I can try to keep fending them off, or I can go for broke and just focus on the lever. Creatures be damned. Like... Ah, god dang it. Like, if we kick out the monsters, we might get caught up and then, like, just killed.
I mean, we're...
But if
we're
we spring for the lever, same thing might happen.
Regardless, we're killing ourselves, so do we let ourselves get killed this way or get killed by saving the world?
Saving the world.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Ready, Fawn?
Yes. I put all of my strength into my legs. The moment the monster in front of me draws back its eel, like arms to grab me, I pivot backwards. My back strikes the machine, sending agony rocketing through my body. I'm so thankful I broke the glass before this moment, before the coming violence. I stretch out and grab the lever. With one last desperate scream that shreds my voice, I jam it down. The tunnel is suddenly filled with a flash of intense darkness. It expands from the switch, swallowing the matter around it. At first, I'm sure this is the end of me. I expect the darkness to consume me, followed by death. But then another shimmer of dancing white light appears next to me. There are more of those streams of light, rips in space like the ones that previously sent me to that other ungodly world in the void. With nothing else to do but die, I try to escape into the shimmer. When that stream of light envelops me, the expanding darkness of the switch is gone, and I feel a huge push.
Oh man, it's my turn, huh?
Yes.
Definitely, maybe.
Oh.
Whoa, it looks beautiful.
My body feels stretched, collapsing, like I'm falling in all directions at once. The world goes white, and then there are the pinpoints of stars everywhere. One of them breezes directly by my right, and I see something that looks like a spiral galaxy distorted in its folds. To my right, I see an endless stretch of stars and gas clouds, forming some galactic architecture. But beyond the immeasurable beauty, I notice something. I am seeing the same star patterns over and over. They are repeating light reflections in an endless mirror. Are these These are different versions of the same galaxies, the same realities. To my left, I see a calm blue world and barely make out trees, familiar Kentucky trees that I've been around for the last few weeks. To my right, I see a copy, an orange world, but there are trees as well. But something is strange, disturbing. As I zoom by, I'm not sure how much control I have in this unusual place, but if I can direct myself, it's worth trying. So should we go to the orange world or the blue world?
The blue one.
You take the red pill home. Or
just
the...
because it's blue?
Yeah.
No,
well,
besides the word orange, disturbing, blue.
Yeah.
Oh.
What do you think?
Blue.
Blue.
Oh shit, I almost accidentally clicked orange.
Accidentally. I decided to go to the blue world. I try to focus my mind on heading towards the blue world, not knowing what to expect. My breath escapes me for a moment. Everything is dark and peaceful. And nothing hurts.
Okay, you keep reading.
No. Okay. Oh my god, this is it. Better not be a time loop, I swear to fuck. With breath back inside my body, I gasp and open my eyes. I'm back at the logging site. How? I'm not sure. Did the shimmers react with the implosion of the switch? Some other accident? I have no idea. I sit up right away and become instantly dizzy. I wonder if I'm somehow back in time before we found the facility, but what happens next makes me realize that can't be true. There's a tremor in the ground somewhere off in the distance. I hear a metallic groan. The buried facility is being ripped apart under the ground by the activation of the switch. I hear trees splintering and popping all around me, and then there's a muffled sound of an implosion. The huge group of trees is falling, followed by a massive plume of dust and debris. There's no way Barksdale and Marcus survived. Good riddance. I look in the direction where I found Dennis sitting before this all started. It's then that I remember that he's gone, along with Amy. I'm still not sure how I got out of that facility alive. That, I suppose, is the most important thing. Alone, but alive. It's then that I look up and notice the sky.
Uh-oh, Vaughn, you ready?
Vaughn.
Yes, UFOs, yes, oh my god. Yes. UFOs, dun, dun, UFOs.
Sorry, my dog right is now. UFOs. My dog is distracting me.
Woof.
Tree. The sky is beautiful and familiar, unobstructed by the trees that had been standing several minutes ago. I exhale and let my body start to relax. It's finally over. I'm not sure how long it will take me to get back to some semblance of life. But I know one thing for sure. Any day above ground is going to be a good day. The end!
The Yay! End.
Aww. We survived.
Jeez, I am so gonna play this over again and record it or something. Oh my god.
Well, there's so many choices. Tough it out. You and 64% of players didn't take painkillers.
Who survives? Literally no one. 38% of players didn't shoot the right barrel. God dang it.
Because they lie. 70%
of players didn't kill the man. Rip. 83% of us went to the... Yeah. Oh my god.
I just realized I've been talking to you guys for the past, like, hour, but I've been muted.
Wow.
Good job.
Rip.
This whole entire time, have you just thought that we've just been ignoring you?
Also,
if you haven't muted, I'm leaving the meeting thing.
Yeah.
So, I don't think they'll be able to hear me.
You're going to end this meeting. Oh my gosh, guys, that was intense.
Wait, Velvet.
Jeez.
If you like to test out beta versions of our upcoming games, we'll do that soon.
Fuck
yeah.
You guys should play Until Dawn.
Oh my god.
Until, oh god.
Guys.
What's up?
Let's just say this was an interesting
that game. Was god damn it, Amy died. Fucking like god freaking Dennis died.
I mean, what son happens if we would have let Amy and Dennis like live? What would happen? Would they all come and be at the same place? Or what happened if we went to the orange place? I mean, since you kind of read most of the story, you can just click, 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 click. So, it's just amazing.
They just all have, like, a massive orgy.
I enjoyed that.
Sorry.
Well, I mean, I actually didn't think Amy was going to die.
God, like, God, fucking... Ugh. Faulty labeling.
Lucy,
God,
you can't hear you.
No, I swear to God, it said that it was gray.
Kim,
I'm so bad for that.
I'm so over it. I'm totally replaying that shit.
Yeah, replaying you raging.
My God, are you kidding me?
All right, we're gonna close the stream temporarily, but I might start another game up. Who knows? Thank you guys who are watching.